With those intriguing questions and their bullseye answers, we now close the first technical session. I request to make the best use of time, the audience keep sending their question slips during the sessions so that we can facilitate the Q&A session at the end of the panel discussion. Can I please now request the panel members, members and the panel moderator to take the stage? Mr. Ashish Agrawal and our panel moderator, Mr. Sunil Parekh. To give you a brief background of our panel members today, Ms. Sangeeta Modi, a co-founder and managing partner of XS Asset Managers, which invests in unlisted small and mid-cap businesses in India. She has 25 plus years of experience in debt and equity investing. Mr. Akash Jain, a director with Creador, which partners with passionate entrepreneurs to grow world-class businesses in South and Southeast Asia. He has 17 plus years of experience with various reputed firms. Mr. Sanjay Randhar, the MD of GVFL, an independent autonomous board managed VC, which has over the past two decades raised 8 venture funds and has supported over 80 companies. Mr. Sanjay Randhar has 30 plus years of experience in financial services space and more particularly in private equity, venture capital and banking. Mr. Ashish Agrawal, with several years of experience, is a founding member and principal at India Alternatives, a SME focused fund. This panel is going to be moderated by Mr. Sunil Parekh. He is the founding curator of the Global Shapers Initiative Ahmedabad, an initiative of World Economic Forum, Geneva. He has 30 years of experience of industrial and professional experience, including 15 years as CEO of international businesses in Africa, Europe, and US. Over to you, Mr. Sunil Parekh.
Well, friends, we must admit that in the morning we had a very, very good overview of the entire gamut of issues and the kind of challenges that both sides have, the kind of apprehensions that are there. So this session is actually titled Post-Investment Challenges for an Investor. So is that mindset that we would like to have you. And therefore, we would like to now dwell deep into the mind of the investor. And we'll now flesh out some of the major areas that were highlighted in the first session. And therefore, the question is, an investor takes a decision. He has now put money into a company in a phased manner, and the journey has begun. What is it that an individual investor or a company has in his hands to make sure that the desired outcomes are along the lines that were planned? And really, what happens during the journey? And I think that particular graphic that we all saw was so descriptive of the reality compared to the gloss that has been shown over. So let me begin first, ladies first, Sangeeta. I'd like you to take the mic and take us through this question of where do you really draw the line between that of being a manager and getting involved in management and remain strictly as an investor doing strategic thinking and merely monitoring? You know? That's your mic.
Yeah, so we almost never stay strictly as an investor. We see ourselves as people who are actively involved, you know, in the businesses. Having said that, we do a lot of funneling before investing. So on an average, we might see around 500 transactions a year and close one or two. So we've pretty much made up our minds that these are the one or two businesses we want to work with. Having said that, again, our approach is, you know, if you've done your due diligence, etc., then your involvement should not be on governance and policing. It should be on growth. So the first premise is that you trust the person who you're investing in, because if you're going in with policing eyes, you won't be able to participate in growth and the conversation won't be there between the two of you. You can never ensure that the business will grow well. You know, if you could ensure it, the entrepreneurs would do it. And we are minority stake investors, and we've realized that the entrepreneurs are far smarter than us in running businesses. We will back the entrepreneur, and we will help the entrepreneur in wherever he sees need for us to help. when we screen our transactions, we make sure that there are certain entrepreneurs who have excellent businesses, excellent quality of entrepreneurship, but they don't want involvement from the fund because they say, I'm good as it is, give me your money and you know, come for my quarterly meetings, I'll give you all the MIS required. That's probably not an association for us. For us, it is the entrepreneur who needs help, who is a first-generation entrepreneur, probably doesn't come out with this, and is comfortable dealing with us, because from the entrepreneur's point of view also, this is a fund you want to work with. So I will say, you know, and I'm probably speaking for a lot of private equity funds today, it's probably the true, you know, a similar situation. In most cases, you will be actively involved.
Thank you. Ashish, when there is a genuine disagreement between the entrepreneur and the investor, it could be that the pace of growth is not comfortable on either side, or the market that you want to enter, the pricing that you want to do, and a variety of issues including appointment of some very key people. Then how do you really handle a major disagreement when there are actually diametrically opposite views and both feel that they are right?
So when we make investments, and as Dhanwal was saying in the morning, it's like a marriage, right? It's a limited period marriage, thankfully. And in any marriage, there's always disagreement. There may be a lot of love, but there are always disagreements. And you have to actually, you know, take care of those disagreements to make the marriage work. Similarly, in the investments, when you look at it, there are, you know, there are issues that sometimes promoter needs knows better. Sometimes the promoter also has to understand there are some certain issues that investors, based on their past experiences, different companies and different industries knows better. Okay, so how do we manage it? How do we go about it? We go it in a very systematic way. We just go to the entrepreneurs, tell them our view, tell them the reasons that we are going to, why we're trying to do that. Okay. There are parallels that we can draw from different experiences that we have. We try to explain them that parallel. For example, we have invested in a lingerie company, okay, and when we were looking at another bag company, it was interesting that the business dynamics were similar. So we went to them and explained them the dynamics that can be going forward. So they also appreciate this kind of stuff, and thankfully it's a partnership approach. A lot of entrepreneurs do understand that we are coming from the experiences of building businesses in the past, and they tend to sometimes disagree with us. We work with them, we persist if sometimes we feel that, you know, things are not right. For example, we in Enamor itself, which is a lingerie company, they had a marketing campaign which they were very, very happy about, and they thought it was working very well. And as an investor, when we came in, we said, no, this is something which is, it was something called Transform Yourself, which talked about women transforming themselves. They said, no, women don't want to transform themselves, they want to feel good about themselves, you know, when they were wearing lingerie. So there was some disagreements to start with when we were, you know, looking at it. But then we actually hired and we helped them, we hired a brand consultant. Brand consultant went to the market, came back with the thing that, yes, women don't want to transform themselves, they want to feel good about themselves. And we changed our thing from transform yourself to, you know, fabulous as I am. And it is working well now, you know. So these are the things that will always happen. You approach them with a consultative mindset, try to give them the positive side of it, and thankfully for us, we have seen promoters do understand it and take it in their, you know, stride.
Okay, thanks. I would also request Akash to look at this issue, because I'm sure it's a very important topic, because disagreements do take place. Some are fundamental, some are very difficult. How do you handle this?
See, I think the fundamental rationale is that, okay, I think the fundamental rationale is we are all mature people, and I think we need to handle disagreements in a mature manner. And I think the second most important thing is that there should be trust and respect between the partners. I think if there is trust and respect, and you know that you are partners, I think most of the issues can be handled in a mature manner. There always be, I think most of the private equity investors don't get involved with regular operating matters and decisions. They don't. I think they leave it to the promoter. They have backed up entrepreneur. They leave it to him. I think the question only comes in issues which are extremely critical for the company in the future. And in case there are disagreements, I think most of the time, if there is a mutual respect and trust with each other, if two people, mature people, are talking, I think you can sort it out. I think what fundamentally happens is that once you have longer discussions on these topics, a lot of these things get thrashed out. And I have not seen too many challenges in situations where you have a good working relationship with the promoter, then certain issues just become out of hand, because you realize why the promoter wants a certain thing, and the promoter realizes why you want it. And I think there's always means and ways of going about it in a manner which works for everyone. But I think if fundamentally there is no trust and respect, I think then it becomes challenging for all critical decisions in the company.
Just to how to deal with it at times, you know. Sometimes, for example, we also let the promoters see the light of it by showing them that way and let them go that way themselves, rather than pushing us, pushing them. You know, for example, another company. This company is an IT product company. They wanted to focus on US. They are focusing on US. We thought that it makes a good sense to actually focus in Southeast Asia also, because there is a demand for that. Promoter was not ready for that. He was saying, no, I will not want to do that. What we did, we just met them, meet the guy there once who was trying to take it off. They met, and then we backed off. We said, okay, you meet them. If you like them, you do it. If you don't like it, don't do it. They met them. They had serial number of discussions, liked each other. Now they're doing business together. So that's how it happens. You know, you have to take it slowly, you know, cajole them, help them to see the light and take it forward like that.
Sanjay. Sangeeta, could give the mic to him. Sanjay, as the head of GVFL, our pioneering venture finance company in Gujarat, which started way back in 1990, the question that I have for you is the same question, but with a different context. For example, you have an entrepreneur who wants to develop his second generation. You know, his children are now wanting to get into the business. You have invested during that phase. You are not really comfortable with this dilution of authority. But at the same time, you also see merit that if the second rung starts getting developed, then it's good for your investment and for your business as well. But things don't go the way you had planned. The promoter is very keen that he wants to get his children into the riding seat. And you as an investor see this timetable not matching with your horizon. How will you handle this tricky issue?
So I think you have mentioned a very pertinent point, you know, because more often than not, particularly in Indian context, you know, it's a family business, and entrepreneurs, and especially in Gujarat, that's what I've seen, which you mentioned, you know, they want to pass on the legacy to the next generation, and rightfully so, but at the same time, the entrepreneur has to realize that investor has come in with a specific time horizon, and that is very clearly established at the time of investment, and they have to facilitate the exit. Now, if the new generation is competent enough and there is an alignment of interest, then there will be no issue. So I think all along the investment cycle, the alignment of interest is very critical. And right from the day one, you know, if people know that, you know, we have to give them an exit, the value of the shareholding for an entrepreneur is also increasing. It's not as if, you know, at the time of exit, the value of the company is going down. It's only that he has to realize that now a new set of investor has to come in, or in some other way he has to give an exit. But if he wants to do that succession planning, then it can't be, you know, as a shock to the investor. It has to be planned up front, and investor has to be taken on board. You can't, you know, pop up this thing at the time of exit or close to the exit that now my son or my daughter is going to join the company. If they are professionally qualified, they would be pretty much welcome, but at the same time, investor has to be on board. I think that's.
Sangeeta, I'd like you to take on the question, when the entrepreneur badmashi sharu kare to tu shu karis?
You know, honestly, in India, and vice versa.
And we are coming to that.
So the power in India, most of the private equity funds are minority funds. And whatever we say, the power is really in the entrepreneur's hand. And when we go in, we are very well aware that, you know, we can write in the agreement whatever we want, we can posture and say, but the power is ultimately in the entrepreneur's hand. If the entrepreneur has started doing badmashi, you can try and do what you want, but you can't control it. You've made the wrong investment decision. And you've just backed the wrong person. You know, so there's very little you can really do after he started doing badmashi. At best, you can see, you know, where there is alignment of interest and, you know, where you can make it more profitable for him so that you make more profit. So he will, if that's the fabric of the entrepreneur, you can only help the situation where, you know, either giving you an exit or, you know, making something good for you works for him as well. But when it is a minority investment transaction, we can have all the agreements we want and we can write whatever we want in the agreement. It's pretty much, you know, a situation where, you know, we have to be backing the right entrepreneur.
Ashish, when things go south, it's not working out for whatever reason, what would be your approach? Take a haircut, cut your losses and get out quickly? Or give it all that you have to make sure that it works like a Hindu marriage? And when do you actually take a call that enough is enough, you know?
It depends on when the problem started, right? You know, so as that picture was there, it is absolutely like that. You know, Mahesh had got it spot on. There will be problems that will come. At times you'll feel, oh my God, ab to kuch nahi ho sakta. We have to take the losses and cut. But in real life, it doesn't happen like that. Okay, we try to do several steps to start try to revive the company first. You know, so there are several examples in the industry which they have done it. I can think of one example, which is Snapdeal, which is a darling of the investors now. It started as a, you know, group buying concept. Okay, it didn't work. I'm sure the investors were panicking at that point of time. But then they persisted with it, pivoted the model. They made it online e-commerce, and now they're one of the top three online e-commerce. So there are examples where something like that has happened. You know, there are, I can think of another example where people come and change the CEO. The CEO may not be working out. Maybe the promoter is involved too much, which he may not want to be involved that much. So someone brings in a professional CEO with equity stake. I know Dhanpal has done that in the past in one of the companies, and company started doing well. So, and at times you'll feel, okay, now we have persisted with the company for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, things just is not doing better. It may be out of control of the promoter, it may be the competency issue of the promoter, we have taken a wrong call, we try to do a lot of diligence before we do that. It may be competency issue. I have seen competency issues as to is very, very minimum, because we do a lot of diligence before that. There are only few cases you will see that. It mainly sometimes when things are not under control of the promoters, you know, regulation changed, you know, market changed, market dynamics changed, and the promoter has not been able to adapt to that. So there are several things that we try. At the end of when we realize that nothing can be done, take the losses and, you know, write it off. That's what you have to do finally.
Because Tarun raised this issue, you know, that $45 billion has been invested and $19 billion has been returned from the period 2005 to 2008. The wait is long, the returns are low, and the past performance of these funds has not been attractive enough as compared to many other alternate methods that one could have invested in. And that brings us to the question of this model of private equity investment. One is the institutional model, where people raise funds, they have investors, then they have a fund manager who goes out and meets, you know, the various entrepreneurs and then invests. The other one is a little more personal, which is what we call the boutique firms. The small firms where the equity is that of the individual who is investing, and there is a great depth of understanding, there is a relationship, there is proximity, and relatively few deals are done, but they are done well. So I'd like both Sangeeta and you, Sanjay, to answer this, because you are institutional and she's more on the lines of a boutique firm, you know, where the relationships are better. In terms of return on your investment, which model do you think? Is there a merit in a model of how do you approach this and what works better?
I don't think, you know, there's a single answer to such a thing. You know, one size fits all is never true. So every investment is a unique investment. Every investment case has to be dealt with a multitude of factors, including the promoter's mindset. You know, when we invest, we like to spend a lot of time with the promoters themselves. Besides the business evaluation, which keeps happening, it's very important for a fund manager to understand the psyche of the entrepreneur over there, and whether they can work together, because they are getting, you know, to a partnership model, and therefore, you know, that assessment becomes very, very critical right at the beginning itself, and that defines the journey going forward.
So you don't see really a difference in the approach of a large firm or a boutique firm?
Fundamentally not.
You don't feel so?
Fundamentally not. But the only luxury perhaps a boutique firm can have is that, you know, they have more flexibility in terms of extending the exit timelines or the investor pressure which is there, because we typically deal with institutional investors. And when you deal with institutional investors, they have a set time frame that, you know, within this time frame, I must get my money back. Whereas if you are a boutique firm, you have a limited set of investors whom you work very closely with, or, you know, you are a family office or something, then you can go back and explain to the investor very easily and convince him that, yes, there is a merit in, you know, continuing with an investment or extending the fund timeline to get and realize more value. Whereas for an institutional fund, it becomes a big challenge, because our investors don't really appreciate that.
Yeah, I don't think it's so much the platform, whether it's institutional or boutique. I think it's the people. And most investors, when they invest in private equity funds, especially overseas institutional investors, actually study the people. So, you know, that example you brought is a very disturbing, I mean, the numbers you brought is a very disturbing fact for the industry. And part of the reason why we've had such few exits is this industry went through some kind of a sea change in 2005, 2006, where suddenly from something like 100 funds, we had 350 funds. We had a huge number of first-time fund managers. And there is no substitute for experience. So when we had inexperienced fund managers, you know, they probably did not anticipate what were the many things that could go wrong. It's probably the quality of the investors and the experience of the investors which can probably, you know, make, which can probably determine a better performance of a fund as such. And probably my experience is probably better partnerships as well from a portfolio company's point of view. You know, addressing your specific question, a lot of successful funds today are partnership funds, but a lot of the people who run those partnership funds are people who have come from an institutional background. So we used to work for Aureus, which is a UK government controlled fund, and then there are examples of much larger funds like Multiples, Ajay Raylan's fund, which have come from institutional platforms, but they've set out on their own.
Let's talk about returns a little bit. In a recent survey, they showed that the private equity funds in India have given a return. Let me ask specifically, let's talk about the four or five big ones. And they have seen a return of about 26% IRR return and in rupee terms and 20% in dollar terms, because as Dhanpal and others mentioned, a lot of source of this money is in dollars. What's your kind of experience? And I'd like to take these questions across, not as a reflection of the kind of deals you have made, but what is your perception of the inherent risk in this class of assets? You know?
When you look at, so everyone who is investing right now across the board here, everyone wants a very good return which is better than a public market return, but otherwise in such an illiquid thing, no one would like to invest, right? I don't know your numbers, the data that you have talked about, the problems have been returns for the for a lot of funds, for our LPs to come and invest in us. You know, we have seen that LPs saying that yes, you've done a good, very good return on an Indian rupee term, but dollar comes and actually, you know, ruins the party, right? Because the vintage of the fund which started at when the dollar was 50, you know, now the dollar is 768, some of those funds, even after doing a lot of good deals, are having trouble. You know, in terms of risks that we take, we try to, you know, try to find a company where the potential is to become 2x or 3x of revenues and profitability in 3 to 5 years. What we are looking at is that it's a portfolio approach, as you know, as Tarun was saying, there will be no PE fund, at least I know there will not be any PE fund which will not have one or two bad companies in their portfolio. So you have to look at portfolio as a whole, you have to balance the portfolio, you look at making return of 20 to 25%, and that's the kind of return that anyone would want to, because otherwise people will not invest in us, so we'll have to give them those kind of returns. So we try to see companies where we will get those kind of returns. We do a lot of diligence for that. We talk to people, we invest in promoters who have the competence to do all this kind of stuff. That's from our perspective, I would say 25% IRR return is something that we would expect from any company that we're looking to invest in.
If funds can return 25%, I will sell my house and put money in those funds. I think what you hear are few cases where a lot of returns have come in, but I think a lot of people don't know about all the other investments which have not made money. I think it's important, in a typical private equity fund, you will invest maybe in 12 to 13 companies. You will make super normal returns, maybe 5x, 6x in a few of them. And I think obviously they get mentioned more often. But I think, as Ashish was also mentioning, there's always going to be underperformers in the portfolio as well. I think as fund managers, I think the vintage, unfortunately, if you are investing in an asset class which is illiquid, unfortunately, the vintage of the fund and at what time are you investing that fund becomes very important. Because both your entry and your exit to a large extent is dependent on how the sentiments are, how the markets are at that point in time. And you can look at funds of 2007, 2008 vintage and realize that people have actually not made money. A lot of funds will actually even struggle to return back capital in those vintage of funds. And if you look at 2010, 2011 vintage funds, you will see that there will be a lot more success stories. So I think with experience over a period of time, most of these fund managers hopefully will be able to pace their investments. They will become more experienced, more sensible about investing. If you ask about our fund, I think what we have tried to do in our fund is keep a fairly flexible approach as far as investing is concerned. So we do both listed as well as unlisted companies. We invest in SMEs, we also invest in fairly mature companies. So we have invested in a company which is $1 billion in market cap. The idea of doing a lot of these kind of flexible transactions is that you can probably pace your entry as well as exit and try to maximize returns. But I think making money in India is very tough. I think entrepreneurs realize it, and I think all investors realize it. I think these are all stories which you should not believe in. I don't think we make that kind of money.
Time for you to sell your house. Invest in my next fund. But, our approach is very different. We invest in only SME businesses, only unlisted businesses, sub 100 crore businesses. We invest in few businesses. We will probably not invest in more than 7 businesses in a fund. So if a business does badly, it can really, really, really impact us. So we are very, very careful about the businesses we invest in. If a business has generated less than 18% return, it is not a successful investment for us. Given the kind of business environment we have in India today, it's not that difficult to find businesses which are growing at 30% per annum. So if the business is growing at 30% per annum, why is your return less than that business? And it's not unusual for us to see businesses which are less than 30% per annum. So, as a fund, you will have a lot of loading which you put onto the investor. You'll have fees, you'll have, profit share as fund managers. But as a gross IRR, if you're not targeting 25%, then what are you targeting for your investors? If you're seeing, ultimately the returns you make, we are not VC funds, so we don't expect any growth because we entered cheap and we are going to exit expensive. Most of the time, the returns that we make are directly linked to the growth of the business. So if the businesses are growing well, we will, we should make commensurate returns.
Thank you.
So I think, like the panelists say, I mean, we as investors would always look at returns on a portfolio basis. And but at the same time, each company has to, you know, there has to be a target return for each company. And without that target return on a portfolio basis, you can never achieve your target that is there. So everyone wants to target upward of 25% IRR in each company. But on the portfolio basis, I would tend to agree that it is very difficult to make that 25% plus on an entire portfolio basis as such. It also depends at what time your fund started and when is your exit cycle, how's the economy going on at that point in time, what kind of exit opportunities you get. Sometimes, you know, businesses just get caught up in a down cycle and your fund, then it becomes a little bit of a challenge while the company might have grown pretty well. And also very important, I think one point which I just want to introduce at this point in time is, you know, exit and return is always talked about for the funds, for the fund and for the investment manager. While we always have a fiduciary duty towards our LPs, you know, that we have to give them return. But because here I believe bulk of the audience is entrepreneurs, there is also, I just want to introduce this point that, you know, the entrepreneurs also have a fiduciary duty to facilitate an exit because they are taking money based on certain trust with the investor. That yes, at the time of taking investment, I have not seen any entrepreneur saying, no, it'll be very difficult for me to provide you an exit. Everyone says, yes, we'll definitely do this. And at the time, when the exit comes and the time for investment manager to make returns come, they have different ideas. I mean, one you mentioned about succession planning, but that's not very often, but there are several other things which come into the mind of the entrepreneur at that point in time, whereas the return, you know, doesn't come through. So I just, but I thought I'll introduce that.
He is reluctant to tell us the truth. But it's a fact, yeah. The whole idea of getting money from a VC or a private equity fund is that it is strategic capital. It is a fund that comes with mentorship and support for creating value in the enterprise. What happens when the entrepreneur feels that the engagement is not creating value and it is essentially just money? So in that kind of a situation, what have you experienced in your, this is for you, Akash. Have you experienced a situation where the entrepreneur says, paise ke siwa ek contact nahi diya, ek business nahi develop kiya, ek acha general manager dhoondke nahi diya, to phir kya diya hai mujhe?
I think paisa, don't undermine the importance of money as well at that point in time for the entrepreneur. I think it's very easy to say sirf paisa diya hai, but right time pe paisa dena bhi bahut important hai. So to me, giving capital is not a commodity. I think it's very important for everyone to understand capital is not a commodity. If an SME today wants to raise money, an IPO market may not be easy for him. He needs to get capital either from high net worth individuals or from funds. So I think don't undermine the importance of capital at the right time, because capital at the right time can really take the company on a different trajectory for growth, right? I think the role that a private equity investor plays in the company, I think changes with the life cycle of the company and the needs for the company at that point in time, okay? It can start off by providing capital. The needs for every company is very different. If you are investing in a larger company, they may have requirements which are very different from a smaller company. Even two smaller companies may have very different needs. So I think the role that a private equity investor plays, I think evolves over a period of time. And I think lots of times when things are going good, and if there is no need for intervention and there is no need for value add, then why do you want to value add, right? I think the need only arises, I think the value add or what you can put in also comes in as per the needs of the entrepreneur and the needs of the company. There are a lot of entrepreneurs who like to involve their investors a lot more. And I think there the involvement is also very high, because I think it's a two-way process in terms of their seeking advice and intervention and us providing it. Khali capital, see, I don't know how to put it. See, the needs are very different for each company. I think that is the most important thing. And some entrepreneurs need more intervention, more advice. So every entrepreneur is very different, right? Some entrepreneurs will seek more. They will want to take more advice. Some entrepreneurs are more want to do it themselves more as well. The needs are very different, both from the lifespan of the company as well as the needs of the promoters. I think most of us invest substantial capital. Our own economics depends on the outcome of the company. So there is no reason for us not to be working towards making a investment successful. I think there should be no doubt in anyone's mind that there is a complete alignment of interest, which is basically that we want shareholders' value to grow, both for us as well as for the promoters. A lot of how you involve or how much you are involved with the company is a process in terms of what is the need at any point in time and how the whole process is, goes post-investment.
Thank you. Very good, frank answer. You want to add? Yeah, please.
Life cycle is very important, you know. When a VC invests and then exits and a the firm comes in, I think the entrepreneur is used to only top line growth at that point in time. His mindset is very different. So some of the tangible benefits that you mentioned are very much there. Which hiring mein kya kiya, isme kya kiya, those are tangible things. But changing the mindset and the strategy, which are very intangible inputs that comes from a private equity player. I mean, I have in my previous firm, we invested into a large retail pharmacy chain. He was funded by some of the marquee VC funds. His whole focus was completely on top line growth. Extremely competent guy, very good firm, but there was absolutely no focus on profitability. I want to open so many stores, I want to grow my top line. That was because that's how, you know, with VCs he was working. But we changed the strategy in the company, brought profitability into focus. Now someone can say, what is the tangible input that a PE firm gave? But that was very important and very critical input for the future of the company and value creation for both investor and the entrepreneur.
I think once the building blocks are in place, I think the most important part is putting the building blocks in place. And I think once the building block is in place, I think the need for constant intervention reduces over a period of time.
All of you have a lot of experience in investing. I'd like each one of you to reflect back and identify two major, most important key reasons which will make you go away from a particular deal or a particular entrepreneurship.
When we make investments, you know, we, I'm just giving a long answer to a very simple question. We do a lot of diligence. A lot of people, we talk to bankers, we talk to suppliers, distributors, all kind of people to understand two things. If you just move on two things. One, what is that competitive advantage of this company and the longevity of that competitive advantage, you know? How long can that advantage survive? What is he doing better than others which can actually make this company take? Because competition is fierce in everything that you do, you know? So what is that this company does which will make this company grow over a long period of time, because they're there for 4, 5, 6 years, sometimes 7 years, 8 years as well. That is one. Second, we spend a lot of time to understand the quality of the promoter. You know, we invest behind, as a minority shareholder, we invest behind promoters. We have to understand their skill set. We know that they are the subject matter experts. We are not. That's why we are not starting our own company. We are investing behind them. So, quality of the promoter can make or break a company. You know, so there can be a very good company, very good industry growing at a very very fast pace. It's a good company. The promoter is not that good. He will bring it down to the ground. You know. Similarly, there is a company which is not doing well. Promoter is very good. He will do something to turn it around. You know, make it work. Either in that thing, add another product, add another line, do something to do that. So these are, if you ask me, two things: quality of the promoter and the longevity of the competitive advantage. Not only the competitive advantage, the longevity of the competitive advantage. These are two things which are very, very important for us to make investment.
I think Ashish has anyways mentioned that whenever you look at a company, obviously you want to invest in a good company and a good industry and a good entrepreneur, right? It's a no-brainer, right? I think everyone's, even though there are checklists, right, where you will say, okay, I will need to do these things, these are checking out or not. I think at a certain level, it's a very personal business as well, right? My way of investing may be very different from my colleague's way of investing, may be very different from Ashish's way of investing. To me, other than obviously all the tick mark exercises in terms of company, industry, entrepreneur, I think to me the most important thing is whether there is a comfort level with the promoter. And to me, we typically try to meet a promoter at least 4 or 5 times before we end up investing in them and spend a longer period of time discussing all sorts of things. So we meet him for lunch, dinner. The idea is for the entrepreneur to know us and for us to know him. And I think once you meet him over a period of time, you realize how do we each of us react to different situations. And I think to me, that's the most important thing to determine is whether we can work as a partner through ups and downs over the next 5 to 6 years. So everything else, even if it ticks, if there is no comfort with the promoter, I will have a significant challenge in doing investment.
Promoter and the founder comes top of the list for all investors. I would just like to add a little there that we also like to look at the team over there. So, I mean, while promoter comfort is paramount, but the team is also very, very important, whether they have the right set of people with them, particularly as a PE investor when the company is a little, you know, scaled up. And of course, the growth opportunity, so we have to, when we look at investment, we have to look what is the, you know, market size, what is the size of the opportunity, where this company stacks in that space, and what is the opportunity for growth going forward. So these are the two key things that we would, you know, definitely want to tick. But there are obviously, for every investor, there are hundreds of tick marks that you need to have before you take a decision to invest.
Yeah, I would agree with the panel. The single most important factor is the comfort with the promoter. I'm assuming all the business, industry, all that is taken care of. Mm-hmm. And as a corollary of that, if there's even an inkling that you will face what you call badmashi, then it's time to stay away.
But if a person is sitting in front of you, he is giving you the top line of that graphic, you know, showing that this is the business plan, this is, how do you assess him as to what his capability is during difficulties? If things go south, what is his capability? How do you make an assessment? You can assess his passion for the business. You can probably judge his drive. But his, how do you make an assessment of when things go south? How, what kind of resourceful person is he?
You can't. And that's when you decide what's your comfort level with him and how much will you be able to help him at that point in time. Because that's when you can actually roll up your sleeves and be with him, help with financing lines, help with, you know, maybe cutting some resources internally, restructuring the businesses. But you have to have a comfortable working equation at that point in time.
I think we're getting in a few questions, and with the last one from my side, I think we'll then go over to, do you want to gain time on this, Nipam, or can we take our 1 hour as you had promised us? Look, let me ask the audience to add value to all of you. Okay, these are four investors are sitting in front of you. You heard them, you heard their body language. If you had to go and sit with one of them to get private equity, who is the person that you would choose amongst the four? Okay, let's go first. Who are the people who will go with Sangeeta to take money? There are five of them. Who are the people who will go with GVFL, Sanjay? Three, four people. I don't think people need money in this room. Tum log entrepreneur ho ki nahi ho? Akash ke liye? Oh! And Ashish? Four. You are the winner, yeah? No, I think this is also important. You guys also need to compete, no?
He needs to do 12, I need to do 5.
Okay. Let's conclude my part of it by asking each one of you, what is your most favorite investment quote in life?
My favorite quote is actually what he just said, that if chemistry matches, maths will follow.
Chemistry matches, maths will follow. Kya baat hai? Kya baat hai? Yes.
I usually don't use too much of quotes, but I've read one which I thought was very interesting, and my boss used to use it a lot. So I think he always says, be long-term greedy, don't be short-term greedy. I think that's the most important thing for all entrepreneurs and investors.
Very nice one. Sanjay?
Just don't be an investor, be a partner.
Okay. You want to add?
I don't really have a quote. But it's giving up equity is a big decision. So one thing I said, the only thing dearer to than equity to you is your wife. So, you know, be sure you want to give up equity.
On a lighter note, I must say that people say that this relationship between the investor and the entrepreneur is that of marriage. Trust. You will have ups and downs, but you have the resilience to get out of it. You know, so you'll be able to sort your problem out. The tragedy is that this comparison to this situation of marriage is expected to stop in 5 years' time, you know. And on the third year onwards, you start talking about departures, you know, and exit plans. And yet you want to maintain the same kind of resilience that you expect a marriage. I think... he always takes equity money from two, three people at a time. Okay, friends, now let's go over to the audience. Here is a question. According to a panelist, which is better, PE or SME IPO and why? Would one of you want to take it?
It's actually a very different choice, but I would, being an SME private equity investor, I would say private equity is much, much better. And I will try to give some reasons. First of all, SME IPO is a very, very shallow market in India. You will not get quality people, you will not get quality money, and you will not get the kind of respect you want. You know, private equity not only brings you money, you know, but you bring a lot of respectability to the company. You know, a lot of right people start getting, you know, attracted to you. It's not about people. I may not get a person for you, but a person will automatically get attracted because, yes, this fund company is a PE-funded company. Okay? One. Two, SME IPO will not add a lot of other things that we do. For example, we introduce a lot of clients to our guys, you know, in a lot of ways. We know a lot of people, we have a lot of network, you know. Everyone on the table, everyone who is sitting on that side of the table, on an investor side, they have an ecosystem of people who they can bring in. These are the benefits that a PE will give you. As a small company, you need guidance. You just don't need money. It's about guidance. A life cycle of a company from 0 to 50 crores, from 50 to 100 crores, and 100 to 200 crores are all very different journey. So you need PE guys who can actually guide you through all these three stages to make you IPO ready when you are actually going to be, you know, valued in the right way in the market.
Yeah, there is a question based, it's largely on the cost element which is associated with raising private equity funding, and whether in most cases the expenses will be borne by the investor or it's a huge expense for an SME. So I think at any point in time you will need to do a cost benefit analysis of any decision you have to take in life. If you want to raise 50 to 75 crores, there is going to be a cost associated to it. And by spending 50 lakhs, if you are able to raise 60-70 crores and take the company to a different level, I think that's a cost that I think you need to incur. And I think in the mind, I think it's a huge mindset change. If you want to raise private equity funding, I think the biggest change needs to come, which is basically a change of mindset. You should stop worrying about 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, and start thinking much larger numbers. Having said that, I think a lot of investors, including us, typically take most of the expenses when we do an investment. I think it's largely a choice of the company. Lots of times the company runs a process of fundraising in a way that they incur costs because they take care of a due diligence process, both on the vendor diligence as well as legal diligence. But it is completely driven by the company's needs and how they want to run a process, what they want to maximize. If you want to engage with investors on a one-to-one basis, I think a lot of investors will incur and will take up a large part of the cost as well. I don't think that should be worried. But I think that if you want to raise larger capital from outside, I think the change needs to be in terms of how you look at costs. You want to take higher rewards, you have to take some risks, you have to incur some costs.
This is a fairly longish thing, a few questions. Yeah, so just summarizing, you know, looking on why we look only at technology, IT, pharma, etc. as a sector, and why the investment size is 40 crore, not less than 40 crores. And the third question is who bears the cost of exit, like IPO costs, etc. So I think you already mentioned about the cost part, you know, stop worrying about the cost. If you are creating a value, I think you shouldn't bother too much about it. About the sectors, what I'd like to tell you is we as investment managers are raising money from investors and putting in growth capital into the company in sectors where we see tremendous opportunity of growth going forward. In a typical commodity cycle, it'll be very difficult for us to generate the kind of returns that our investors expect from us. And therefore, you would not find too many private equity players who would be very keen to look at investing in typical commodity kind of companies, you know. So private equity investors would look for high growth sectors, that is for sure. Investment size is, I mean, it depends on the fund size. People do large ticket size, people do small ticket size. I'm sure Auris as a fund was doing smaller ticket sizes, SME. There are funds which are focused on SMEs who do smaller ticket size. So you have to pick the right fund and you have to scan the market and look at the right fund.
To summarize the question is post-investment, would an investor be willing to look at listing on an SME IPO? And the answer to that is categorical no, for the same reason that he said. You know, there isn't much depth in that exchange yet. So even though we are getting out, we know that we are most likely not going to get out with a very successful exit. Unless we want to do it for tax planning purposes, because there are tax benefits which now may not be there anymore. So it's not actually a very viable form of exits for PE capital. That's the answer to that. I wanted to add one more thing which he said on costs. For an SME entrepreneur who's raising money for the first time, you really don't have much cost except your advisor's cost, which is your investment banker's cost. My advice to all entrepreneurs is get yourself a good investment banker who has done transactions in the past. It can make a critical difference to your process. Most investment bankers will charge success fees. And those successful fees are anywhere from 3 to 5% of the capital that you raise for a SME company. But it's worth it. Get yourself a banker. Rest of the cost which you have, which is legal, DD, etc., comes in only when there is more or less certainty of the transaction going through, which is post-term sheet stage. Most cases, if it is money coming into the company, you have a case to tell your investor the company will bear the funds, will bear the costs of the investment banker, because the company will have funds once you've raised private equity. So that was just a small insight.
Well, I think I will try for 15 minutes saving. We've done quite a lot in 45 minutes, you must admit, you know. And But however, before we close, I think it would any of you like to give any concluding thoughts or remarks that might have been in your mind that you want to add to anything?
Just want to add something which I've been hearing a lot about the concerns of the entrepreneur regarding private equity. You know, we are not draconian guys. We come and, you know, as Akash said, you know, we give money. Money is very important. We add a lot of value. We don't want to come and interfere with your business if the business is doing very well. If there's a, in that picture, everything is going, the first part of the slide, we just want to have coffee and go back. You know, I would love to do that. You know, I don't want to come and sit with you, try to get my Rolodex out. I don't want to do that. And I have been seeing a lot of change in the approach of the entrepreneurs also, which is a great thing for the industry, I would say. The entrepreneurs are more collaborative. Badmashi wala part has I have not seen, at least, thankfully. At least they don't want to do badmashi because of just doing badmashi, because, see, if you want to save 1 rupee, okay, by, as an SME entrepreneurs, we all want to do tax planning, right? Save tax, 1 rupee pocket mein dal lo, you know. That 1 rupee that you put in pocket, you have lost value by multiple of that, you know, because the valuation that you get is a multiple of the money that you have actually put in the books, okay? Then that's what you have to realize. Yes, you have to be honest about yourself, honest about your business, and be have a partnership approach. If my 10% or 20% increases in value by, let's say, 3x, your 80% is increased by 3x. You know, if that's something that you have to realize, then things will do really, really well for both you as well as us.
I think we discussed pretty much quite a lot, covered a lot of ground. So for entrepreneurs, you have to see this partnership as a partnership. You know, don't think of it that only I have to get this money and be over with it. You have to work along. The way we want to build that trust, it should be a both ways process. You know, you also have to think of it as you want to build the trust, you will want to build a partnership. And on a lighter vein, you know, quite often the marriage part has been mentioned during the discussions, you know. So it's not like a marriage which used to be in olden days where you, this is, it's a modern marriage, and you should know upfront what are your boundaries in that marriage and what is the time for exit. Maybe today we don't think of it like that for marriage, but here we have to see it in that way.
Fellow has really got some serious ideas.
So I was just speaking to Deval, and it's interesting to be addressing our chapter in Ahmedabad, because three of our portfolios are, you know, Gujarati, and I found that Gujaratis are the most challenging people to negotiate with. The experience, and that's coming from a Marwadi, you know. So the experience post investment is very good, but they're really sharp negotiators. So that's probably good. It's good from you know, both sides. There's healthy respect for both sides. But just one small thing. When you're starting the whole PE fundraise process, assess, you know, what is the probability of you succeeding in the process. It's a very time-consuming process. And there is huge funneling at the fund manager's point of view. That, and secondly, a lot of discussions don't go through because there's not enough transparency. Every business which is in a growing business will have some skeletons. You decide at what point in the discussions you want those skeletons to come out. Don't hold back on things so that they come out in the due diligence. So, you know, those are a few parting advices so that, you know, there's more success, more likelihood of success of deal closure.
You're not the only Marwari to have said that. Kishore Biyani in his book has mentioned on page 83, if you can sell in Gujarat, you can sell anywhere in the country. Well, friends, I think it was a very wonderful discussion, and I'd please join us in thanking the speakers for the wonderful insights that they have shared with us today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, all the panel members and the panel moderator. That was an exhilarating session. The apt questions and the perceptive answers have been marvelous. With the end of the first panel discussion, I would invite back the speaker. Can you please stay on the stage? We are having the momentous ceremony. I would also invite back the speaker of the first technical session on stage. Can I please request Mr. Rajiv Mehta, the Vice President of AMA, to present memento to all our speakers, panel members, and moderator of the first technical session. Let's join our hands and give them a huge round of applause. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, speakers, for such wonderful addresses, and the panel members for such amazing answers.
Good morning.